Hi, this is Koiro with another installment in the Leningrad series. This is number 6 in the line, and we will have at least one or two more videos before we are finished with this computer. I will start with applying the capacitors, decoupling capacitors, all over the line, as I said in the end of the last video, and then we will go on to place the oscillator circuit on the board, and we will do some tests before we call it a day for this video. I have shown all this footage where I placed the capacitors and the other stuff on 5x speed, so you can of course even increase it further by hitting fast forward when you play the video as well. I will come back with some other short comments during the video, but when we fast forward, it will be music when I don't have any comments to make about the job I do. As you can see, I'm reusing some rest batches of old capacitors, and that's quite okay for these decoupling capacitors. All of the capacitors I choose for this today is well suited for the task. The capacitors I'm using here ranges from 82 nanofarad to about 200 nanofarad, and that's quite okay for this kind of application. In typical use, people often use 100 nanofarad caps for this. As you have seen, we have mounted all the capacitors on the bottom of the card, and that's a very good and simple solution for this problem, as there was limited space on the component side. But that means that we have to do some other measures to avoid the capacitors from being crushed and that they are getting bent on the underside. So we will drill some holes and put on some slightly longer legs that the card can rest on, and that will also be a solution that we can use to fix it in a case at a later time. Yeah, I think this is the crystal oscillator circuits. But I can be wrong. Yeah, but I think this is right. But I do not like this packaging. This is packed into three layers of highly static electricity items. This plastic and another layer of plastic and this foam here, this bright pink foam is no good anti-static. The black stuff that I normally recommend, like this ones, it's much better. It's highly conductive and it shortens out all the legs at once and gives a good protection against all kinds of static electricity by touch. But this is the 14.31818 oscillators that I ordered. Here are some simple cutouts from the data sheet for the oscillator, and as you can see there are four pins connected. The first pin is NC or 3 state. If you make this pin high you will disable the oscillator. The pin 4 is ground, pin 5 is the oscillator output, and pin 8 is VDD. And we will supply this with 5 volt. The output voltage, as we can see, will swing in about a range from 10 to 90%. The startup time for this is 10 milliseconds, so that's quite fast. Otherwise, we might have to delay the startup of the CPU until the clock is stable. We have just removed the old oscillator circuit with the crystal and the capacitors that was placed around in this circuit, and we are just going to put in the clock signal on the pin that stands as a buffer on the 74LS04 circuit. Thank you. I have turned on the Leningrad. I actually got no picture on the screen, so I'm going to do some quick measurements. And I'm now measuring straight out of the oscillator. And here you have a good signal, although I see it's peak to peak 2.88 volt, and it had some ringing on the top of the bottom, so it actually measures about 2.5 volt on top, and you have some ringing on the square waves that goes below zero. That could just be errors in calibrating the measurement leads and so on, so we don't take that into consideration. This means that the oscillator is actually doing what it's supposed to do. But in the data sheet for this, if you supply it with 5 volt, it should swing about 90 to 10% of the supply voltage, and that should mean from about 0.5 volt to 4.5 volt from top to top on the square. And this is actually about half of that, and I suspect that this might be due to a high load on the circuit. These oscillators is actually made in CMOS technology, and they might not be able to handle the load that 74LS04 is putting on the output. And okay, this is the output of the gate that I feed this into on the 74LS04, and it's high permanently. I will take out the 74LS04 chip and I will measure it in my multi-programmer to see if it actually works or if there are some errors with this. You probably remember that we actually have handled this chip quite brutally by putting in a signal that's much more than 5 volt peak to peak on it when we did the sine wave to square wave transformation. And I don't think that should destroy the chip, but we will test anyway.
The MiniPro programmer is able to test most logic families in the 4074 kind of logic chips, and they have two modes for fixing this. Either you can just put the chip in and test it as an auto select, and then you will get the list of all the chips that has the same truth table. Or you can go from the menu and choose the chip you want and get a more accurate test. But as we see, this chip tests normal, and we will just try to replace it with something else.
As I stated earlier, it kind of looks like the oscillator is kind of heavily loaded and that we are putting too much strain on the output of the oscillator. And I have looked through all my stock of 7404 kind of chips, and I do have some different kinds, but the most promising one I found, I actually looked to see if I had some 74HC or HCT kind of chips, but I didn't find them straight away. But I did find a 74ALS chip, and I was thinking that that's worth a shot, because I seem to remember that the 74ALS had less power draw than the LS chips. I've taken up a comparison here from Fairchild Semiconductor that previously had all these families in their line of products. And they've listed some comparisons here, and what we're looking for is what was typically called fan out, or power draw on the input, or total power draw, or something. Here we have something, a comparison of typical quiescent supply current for various logic families, and of course the less draw they have, the less power it will consume also on the inputs. Here you can see that the ALS TTL chips has less than half on the small circuit integrated circuits.
This is what we was really looking for. As you can see here, this is a diagram that shows the input current for one gate. And it stated that the power required to drive a gate is 400 microamperes for LS logic, and ALS has about half the current draw. This is for the low, but for the high, it's almost no current draw at all. And as you can see the HC CMOS, you can almost neglect the power draw on the inputs of these chips anyway because it's so small. So my first choice would be to put a HC CMOS device here, but I think actually it will be worth a try with the ALS chip as it draws about half the current. And with half the current, you will get less draw on the power, and then you will get more in the line of this 10 to 90% swinging that we should have on the oscillation. This is what I stated earlier, the fan out. The fan out is a measurement for how many logic gate you can drive with the output of your chip. We have now found what we set out to do. The ALS chip will have half the power draw on the oscillator circuit, and it will be able to deliver the necessary current to the 74LS gate that is preceding it. So we will skip the rest of this datasheet as we already have the information we need to proceed. Now I have changed the chip. I didn't have a lot to choose from, but I did have a 74ALS04. And let's see what we got. We get a slightly bigger signal. Okay, now the top is measuring over 3 volts. And that means that this circuit put much less strain on the oscillator than the other chip. And here we have the output. And that actually looks quite good and stable. So I think we can test again with the screen because this clock looks perfect. Okay, this looks totally different from last time. Address error, EC1, IC3 and IC4 suspect. Address error, but we're getting some output in the borders, and that means that they actually testing. Upper memory, okay, the measuring of bad IC. Faulty lower and upper memory cannot proceed further. And I will try again. I actually should have put a reset circuit on this to just be able to reset. They take the same now, address error for memory chips. I have actually don't try to change the memory chip from last time. That gets the same memory error, so we will test this again with the new memory chip placed in the second bit. Now I'm testing after changing the DD23 memory chip, and at least we don't get the error message straight away. This actually looks promising. I think we will get a screen memory okay, yes, lower 16 kilobyte RAM okay. Testing upper memory, that will take slightly longer time. You see the flickering in the picture. I'm not sure, I'm going to turn down this light so you will see better. There are some flickering in the picture, but I don't know if it's the test or if there are still some instability in the video circuits. But now you actually have more information here, and we have color palette test, we have speaker test, internal room test, more RAM test and system and ULA test and spectrum 128 menu. That's not for us, of course. And you have reset. And it's have this timer that's ticking down and it will take a restart. I have not connected the keyboard. I have actually had not had the keyboard connected since the first test I did. So that will be the next step, to connect the keyboard and see if we actually get the keyboard to work in this diagram. Otherwise, as we said before, we actually don't know if this diagram
is suitable for the Leningrad, and that it might will act different in a Leningrad than a Spectrum. So I will try just to see if the keyboard works with the diagram, and after that I will just switch to the ordinary ROM chips and test the computer. But that will be a story for a different night, because now this video has been far longer than I originally anticipated. So I think it's time to say thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed the content, and if you want to be notified when we post another video, please hit subscribe. So see you in the next one.